I think we got a lot to go over today, so let's start the meeting. Good morning. I am Barb Buckley, and I'd like to welcome you all to the here today where we meet to improve lives locally and globally. I am the president of the most awesome and fun club, Rotary Club, in North St. Paul, Maplewood, Oakdale. Let's see, is Joe Miller on today or? Okay.
Doesn't look like it.
How about Rochelle? Would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Okay.
Sorry, I put you on the spot there.
Yeah. I pledge allegiance to the flag. Oh my God. Of the United States of America and to the nation under God. Oh my God. I am so sorry. You put me on this. Let's all do it together. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God.
Indivisible.
For justice. Liberty and justice for all. When was the last time we all had to say that alone versus a group?
That was great practice for you.
Okay, Nina Potter, would you read the four or five-way test, please?
The five-way test of the things we think, say, or do. Is it the truth?
Truth.
Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? And of course, most importantly, is it fun?
So I want that one next time, okay? Or have the words up.
Hey, you know, if you're in Toastmasters, you'd be required to do a 2-minute on the spot every meeting, and boy, does that teach you to, like, you just go.
Yeah, thank you. I'll have to join Toastmasters.
Well, no, just, you just get used, your neurology gets used to it.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, we'll move on. We have a special song from Joe Stallman in honor of our DG visit.
Oh, wow.
Got friends in Rotary. You got friends in Rotary. When the year looks rough ahead, you're miles and miles from your warm, safe bed. Just remember, Mr. Governor Ed, yeah, you got friends in Rotary. Got friends in Rotary. You got friends in Rotary. Some clubs got troubles, we got them too. But there ain't nothing that our club wouldn't do for you. We'll stick together the whole year through, yeah. You got friends in Rotary. Well, some clubs might be a little bit bigger than we are, closer to your club too. But you ain't ever gonna find a club that has the fun we do, not the way we do. And as the year roll by, our membership will never slide. You're gonna see here in NSP, Maplewood and Oakdale. You got friends in Rotary. You got friends in Rotary. You got friends in Rotary.
Great. Gotta write that one down.
I think we can put that one on a CD.
There we go.
That goes on John's departure CD.
Yeah, there we go. Thank you so much, Joe. Not only do we have fun here, some of us have talent.
Thank you.
Here we got somebody's mom visiting.
Yes, Nyongi.
No.
Okay. Rick Pratt, do you have some invocation or words of encouragement or inspiration?
I do. I'll just say that recently I came across a speech made by Paul Harris at the 1940 International Convention. War was imminent in Europe and things looked pretty grim. This is an excerpt from that speech. He said, "All personalities have the power to depress and the power to curse, but also the power to uplift and the power to bless. As Rotarians, with the goal of service above self, let us use our personalities to uplift and to bless." Paul Harris.
Thank you, Rick.
Okay, Randy.
Very nice. Very nice.
Yep. Randy, do you have a morning wake up quiz question?
Yes, I do have a Friday morning wake up quiz question. Remember, we're looking for a person, place, thing, or event. As soon as you think you know the answer, yell it out loud enough that I can hear it. I'll turn my volume up. All right, so here we go. I am the furthest east.
Alaska.
Maine.
That's
what. Alaska's correct.
Alaska.
Alaska is the furthest east, the furthest west, and the furthest north.
Wow. Good job, Noemi.
Wow.
Hey, Noemi.
Must be your good mom one. Whispering in your that, ear.
My good luck charm.
Yeah, I met your mom at the Boy Scouts.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Sergeant says arms.
Yeah, they go to the
want to introduce guests or have happy bucks?
Absolutely. Let's see here. So we got no Randy's here, but I don't have him on my screen. Randy, where are you?
Well, that's kind of a big question, I think, in the big scheme of things. Where exactly are you? And I had a nickel for every time I've been asked that. I seriously would be retired by now.
Myra's here too. Hi, Myra.
Hello. Can you hear me?
We can.
Yay.
You're inside today.
Yes, I am inside.
What's
Joe,
new?
Thank you for that song. That was terrific. And maybe you could introduce our guests as well. I see that our president is here, correct?
Yes. District governor, yeah.
District governor, I'm sorry.
Well, yes, first here? And foremost, yep, the man of the hour is District Governor Ed Marek, and he is making his rounds. What number are we for your clubs?
Number 3.
Woo!
Top 3.
Wow.
Pretty good.
There's number one in your heart.
Yeah, how many clubs do you have to go to?
66.
Get to go to.
I think it's like 63, six. Including the Rotaracts.
Wow.
Rotaract.
Wow. That's a lot.
Well, we're honored to be number 3 on that list.
That's more than one a week.
How close are you
to number 1?
Yeah. That's
close.
We'll hear a lot more from Ed here at the when we get to the meat of the meeting, but thank you very much for being here. I see Kevin from Oakdale's back. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning, Kevin.
Morning, Kevin.
Welcome
good
back.
Good morning.
For those who were not in attendance last week, where are you coming from and what brings you here?
So, like you said, I live in Oakdale. I'm actually a city council member over here and just looking to get involved in the Rotary Club. A friend had recommended that I check it out and, you know, take advantage of another opportunity to serve the community.
Great.
Wonderful. Thank you for joining us.
What's new in City Hall over there?
Not much. COVID has kind of canceled everything. So it's a pretty quiet summer, but you know, we gotta get the budget done, and hopefully, you know, we can not raise taxes too much, so that's good.
Quiet is good a lot of times.
We will take quiet, especially this summer, so
very good.
Okay, I see Claudia raising her hand. She's already happy for us.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. On Thursday, my daughter celebrated her 31st birthday. I don't understand how I can have a child who's 31, being as how I'm only 40 myself, but there you have it.
You're a prodigy.
I guess. She's doing as well as can be expected under the circumstances, and she actually has been working with me. I needed to take on a little bit of help to finish a project, and she was perfectly suited for it. So that's kind of exciting. I don't know how long I can keep her on the payroll, but at least for a little bit. So I will throw in a couple happy bucks for my darling girl.
Wonderful.
Very good.
Great.
There is two more guests, though, before we get too far down the road here. So Noemi has a guest with her.
I have a guest. My family's visiting, and I have family from out of town, so the other half already went to go meet up with them, and Mom stayed with me, and we'll be heading out right after the meeting to join the rest of the family. But she's like, oh, I know him. I've met him, and oh, I've seen her. So y'all feel like family as well. So I'm putting in $10 for just because, Mom.
Well, good. And she's visiting from Seguin?
Yes.
And it's been like 110 degrees there for about 2 weeks straight?
Yeah.
And still one more week.
Oh, yes. Brutal. Yes. Seguin is a suburb just east of San Antonio where I used to live. So I've been to Seguin a couple of times for sure. 30 miles northeast. 30 miles northeast, yeah. Is that off of Highway 10?
Highway 10, yes.
Yeah.
East, awesome. Mostly east, yeah.
110 degrees is pretty darn hot.
That it is.
And then Beverly's here. Beverly, can you introduce yourself, tell us what club you're from and why you're here?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I love your club because you are a really happy, fun club. I'm the assistant district governor. I'm from Stillwater Rotary. So we meet at that nice hour of noon versus this kind of early wake up. So I'm pretty dressed, but you don't want to look at the whole thing yet.
Beth, where are you meeting these days?
We do the virtual meeting, like just like you.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I meant when you go back to real meetings,
we meet in at the Lowell Inn in Stillwater.
Okay, no. That's right.
Nice place.
Okay. Well, welcome.
I think we've got all the guests. Are there any other guests here? No.
Okay.
All right. More happy bucks. Who else is happy? Oh, speaking of happy bucks, there's the link on how to get money into the pot, and everything from this goes to the North St. Paul Food Shop.
I see a lot of hands. Woohoo! That's fantastic. Let's start with Charlotte.
Yes, happy bucks. I'm going to donate $10 for joining Rotary.
Yay!
Welcome.
Hey, Charlotte. Welcome.
Welcome to our club. Yes, we're excited to have you.
Mm-hmm.
And I see a Barb.
Yep, and I'll put in another 10 for having everybody visit today and for Char joining, which we'll get to later.
That right. Sounds wonderful. Ed? And you're on mute. Yeah, there you go.
No, I should be. You should be hearing me. Yeah, I'll throw in happy dollars as well, just to say hello to, as Joe was singing, there are many friends in the group that I know, including Naomi's mother, who I met at the racetrack last year when we were raising money for Polio Plus.
Yes. Well, she really gets around, doesn't she?
Yes.
That's fantastic.
Thank you, Ed.
Oh, I see Sonia has another happy buck.
Well, not another. I will have happy bucks, and I promise this time I will put in money. I promise. Everybody's been putting in 10 bucks, so I'm going to do that. I'm going to match it today. I'm giving a happy buck for Carolyn. She is so talented. I am having a baby shower, a socially distanced baby shower. She has made masks. Look at these are darling masks.
Wow.
Everybody wow. in my shower, invited to the shower. And little table runners that match. So Carolyn is so talented. Let me tell you, she has done a bang up job. So I'm for Carolyn. I'm giving happy bug.
Good.
Well, this we're is lucky to have Carolyn. Might need more explanation.
Thank you.
No, you are amazing, Carolyn. Yeah. So.
She is.
And she's fast.
Randy, another happy buck.
Yeah. So last night was league night. For Trap, and I took my 20 tickets over there and sold 30, so I got to see Kristen because I got some money, but I owe the tickets. So.
I have 10 for you, Randy.
No, those are yours. I'm going to get some new ones.
That's cheating.
I don't get out. I'm stuck at home.
And I sold most of them to Joe's friends. He didn't bring his tickets.
Oh, that's smart. Well played.
Take them in there.
Well, the others out there this morning.
Was that $10 donation, Randy?
That's a ticket. I'll send the money in.
Thank you, Randy. Any other happy bucks?
Sure.
Well,
okay.
Looks like we got them all.
We got a lot of 10 bucks. That's amazing. Yeah, you guys are amazing.
Thank you very much. And I think we got a lot on the program, so let's flip it over to our new president, Barb.
Okay. Some announcements. Board meeting next Tuesday at 7 a.m. the 21st. Get your agenda items to April. And a reminder to the board to stay on Zoom after the meeting today to talk with District Governor Ed. And then also a reminder for those involved with the Rotary Park that on Tuesday the 21st at 8:30 a.m. there's a meeting at Rotary Park to discuss what is left to be done at the park and the opening of the restroom facilities. And we are happy to have a new member, Char Winham. Sean will show us a video of her induction into our club, accompanied by her sponsor, Noemi. It was an extremely windy evening, so we do apologize for the sound quality. Okay, Sean, you ready to play the video?
Our women, you have been proposed for membership in the Rotary Club of Birthday Hall, Maplewood, Oakdale, by Rotarian Noemi McHale, and duly elected. Therefore, it is my pleasure to formally induct you into this club. I understand you are aware of Rotary requirements and that you have indicated your willingness to follow them, as well as your willingness to offer your services to your fellow Rotarians in their community and international projects. As you know, Rotary is a service club, each member performing what Rotary terms as service above self. In addition to service, you will have the benefit of strong bonds of friendship with fellow Rotarians locally and worldwide. Now I present you with a packet of Rotary literature.
Thank you.
I especially commend to your attention the object of Rotary and the four-way test, which forms the criteria for Rotarians in their daily lives. And now, by the power vested in me as president of North St. Paul's Maplewood Oakdale, Noemi will pin the Rotary emblem on you and declare you to be an active member of this club. Welcome to our club. Thank you so much. Welcome to Rotary. Woo-hoo! All look forward to your, the enrichment of our lives as well as that of you all.
We're going to go like this.
By the association in this, the world's oldest, largest, and finest service organization. Congratulations, Jar.
Thank you. I'm so excited to be a member, and I can't wait to meet all of you and find out what you do and why you do it.
What we do and why we do it.
Exactly.
And why we have fun.
Yes. Okay, everybody, let's please welcome Char Winnen. Okay, and we'll move on to today's program. I'll introduce Assistant District Governor Bev Driscoll. Bev became a Rotarian of Stillwater in 2006 and has served as president and has been on the board for 7 years. It has been her pleasure to serve on the district Fast for Hope steering team since 2010. And she has traveled to Nicaragua on two cultural visits and has led two she's led two cultural visits and has been a part of many steering team work sessions in Nicaragua. On a personal level, she has four sons who wonderfully chose four women who are now her four daughters, and she has eight grandchildren. Welcome, Bev.
Okay, thank you, Barb. Everybody can hear me, I hope?
Yep.
Yep, good, wonderful. Okay, it's my great pleasure to introduce my friend Ed Merrick, who is a really dedicated Rotarian. Ed finds Rotary wherever he is. He started out in Shakopee, and then when he moved, he went to Eden Prairie, and he has been with St. Paul Sunrise now since 2001. So that's a long stint in that place, and I think that's probably where Ed's going to end up as a Rotarian. He's been active, of course, on the local level. And he's served as president a couple times, and he's been done leadership times in membership and the foundation and international service, and also serves as a co-leader of St. Paul Sunrise's annual forum, which, by the way, if any of you haven't gone to, would be a really good idea to go. They do a forum in April, sort of toward maybe the third week or so. And right now, I think they do it with Minneapolis and Roseville Rotary Clubs as well. But they are really on top of having topics that are of great interest. They do it in the morning, so all of you guys would be happy to go to it at Town and Country. And I want to say, you know, they have done things on health, on mental health in the jail system, legalizing marijuana. But, you know, one of the things that caught my attention is this forum addressed the issues of race in 2015, which tells you that this is a really good place to learn something and be with other Rotarians who are interested in making the world a better place for all of us. On the district level, Ed has been an AG, and he's also served on the Ethics Committee and a member of the Fast for Hope Steering Committee. Well, Ed can't do just Rotary, so I also had to do a job. And he had a couple of, he works in the nonprofit fundraising. Good for you, Ed, in that area. And he's worked with the American Red Cross, and in that capacity also has been involved in several national disaster areas, including in Minnesota, Louisiana, and Missouri. But then Ed also has been the executive director of the Minnesota Environmental Fund. And that, I have to chuckle about this, Ed, because as I noticed what you indicated are your hobbies, it really fits with the environmental aspect of things. So you and your best friend and wife, Sue, along with your two children, Amanda and Steve, engage in these kind of activities. So this is really interesting. What do? They hike, they canoe, they camp, they kayak, they snowshoe, they cross-country ski, all things that really are involved in the environment and all things that make a really, you know, have no impact on the environment when you're playing. And when they're not outside doing those things, they read together, which is fun too. So that's Ed. He does Rotary, he does work, he does family, he does play, which kind of reacts, is kind of good for your club, which is a fun club. So Ed knows how to play too. But I want to say one other thing about Ed. It's been my privilege to know Ed for about the last 11 years or so. And we met in Nicaragua on one of the district's Fast for Hope meetings. I learned a lot about Ed during all these Fast for Hope issues. He's an enthusiastic and energetic person in doing service above self and in helping people, not giving a hand out, but giving a hand up, which is really the way we want to go. And we've learned this is the best way to go. So what do I know also about Ed? He's energetic. He's patient. He's kind. He's creative. And I know he's going to be a fabulous district governor. So, Ed, I'm giving you my best virtual hug, and I'm really sorry it's not in person. So, here, welcome to the podium.
Thank you, Bev. And a big hug back. I miss those two. If you've never gotten a hug from Bev, you're really missing out. So I'm just saying. And if you're lucky enough to hit her on a double hug day, it's like bonus. I do want to clear up one thing, though, with the introduction, is those disasters I was on, I did not cause any of them. I was just there to help. Just wanted to make that clear for everybody. thanks for having me today. I look forward to visiting clubs. I know, I think I've been out to your club in the past talking about Fast for Hope, and I know last year I was out there talking about the foundation, and I showed up last year also when District Governor Paul Perez showed up, and supported him in that time. I would have preferred doing this in person, but we live in challenging times. So I appreciate your willingness to meet via Zoom. Excuse me. As the recent Around the District newsletter described, we want to make sure that clubs are both staying safe and inclusive. And I've been amazed at how seriously Rotary International has been dealing with the pandemic. In March, they immediately suspended all travel by RI staff and senior leadership through the end of this year, December 31st. They're still recommending that all meetings be virtual, canceled, or postponed, and they also recommend following guidance from local governments. Clubs, of course, are autonomous, can make their own decisions. The district, we recently sent out recommendations to the presidents, so if you decide to begin meeting in person, we have some guidelines there, but do be careful. This is nothing to fool with. RI is also concerned about meetings beyond the end of this year. I recently received an email from RI President Holgar recommending that the Conference of Clubs next spring be held virtually, which it will be. You know, Rotary International is commuting with the WHO, the World Health Organization, and I think they have a better sense of the impact of the pandemic than we're getting with all the conflicting information that is reported in this country. But on to your club a little bit. I've really been impressed with your club. You know, you're coming up now on 40 years this year. Congratulations on that. I see Mo is here with us today, who's been around since the beginning, and I'm sure he's seen any number of changes over that period of time. Brian, I saw as well, been with you for 35 years, which is the club anniversary my club is coming up on, so we're not too far behind you. But the scholarships, the involvement, the commitment to youth through, you know, the money you give to Boy Scouts, the scholarships that you give out to students is great. YMCA, we also support, and you're doing the same thing. Polio Plus, you got Joe jumping into rivers with Paul. That had to be cold. I don't know. I did that once many years ago, and jumping from a sauna into a lake, and I did it in November, and it was incredibly cold, and I thought, this is stupid. But a more stupid thing to do was to do it in March. It seemed even colder, which I did in March. The other thing is I saw the World War II veteran presentation that you helped sponsor with that grant for that student. kudos. That was just an amazing story. And that young woman had such poise, and it was very impressive. It was one of our Friday features where I got to see it. And something that was near, well, two things that are near and dear to my heart is Anita. Hello, April. Anita, with the LEAP Award for the rain garden work you're doing with your the Rotary Park. And finally, Timor-Leste, working with the road and completing that road. I got to spend time with Graciana and Nasia when they were here with the GSE team. I took them around for the first few days, and they were just delightful. The whole crew was. And so great. Thank you for doing that for them. That's tremendous. Last year, two more things. Welcome to Charlotte. Welcome aboard the Rotary. You're going to have a great time. And Kevin, pay attention. Charlotte's doing the right thing. This is a great club to join. So jump on board. Don't hesitate. Last year, when the new vision statement was introduced by Paul, together we see a world where people unite and take action to create lasting change across the globe, in our communities, and in ourselves. I was struck by two aspects of this statement. First, that we create lasting change in ourselves. That's where all permanent lasting change begins, within each of us. It then radiates out from us to the people around us, to our communities, and off to the globe. As Gandhi said, you must be the change you want to see in the world. The second thing was that nowhere does the word Rotary or Rotarian appear. It was a recognition and an invitation for all sectors of a community to come together to make lasting change. And as Paul pointed out last year, we're going to do that by increasing our impact, expanding our reach, enhancing participant engagement, increasing our ability to adapt, which these days I think we're doing a pretty good job with. President Holgar had set out four goals for the year. The first was to actively work at creating new innovative club models. He suggests that each club can do that by creating a satellite club. You're meeting in the morning, and people in your communities, the three towns, may not, like Bev, may not want to get up this early in the morning. So you may want to consider forming a satellite club to increase membership. It's another way to go. There's a club down in Boone, Iowa, that had a town of about 12,000 people. They had a noon club, and they created a satellite club that meets twice a month in the evening, like about 5:30. And they made it family friendly. So they have teachers and a nurse showing up. 15 people joined it. And the member there, who's a counterpart to me, is the district governor now for District 6000 down there, shared a photograph of a recent meeting. And there were the two teachers and the nurse there who can't come during the day because of their jobs, but wanted to give service, wanted to be involved in the community. They joined, and they bring their kids with them. So it can be family friendly as well, which is taking all the obstacles out for people getting involved. I think makes a lot of sense. The second thing he said is that we should host at least one strategic meeting each year at which you ask, where should our club be in 5 years and how are we going to get there? What value do we bring to our members? And select somebody to lead that effort. Another great way to do this in our district is to do a club visioning session. And you may want, if you haven't done one of those recently, you may want to consider doing that. The district visioning team has now created a virtual club visioning session. And if you've ever gone through a visioning session, you may remember the part where we put up all the things we'd like to consider doing, and we get to vote with stickers up on the wall. And if you've been to one of those, you know you have to wait till everyone makes their decisions, puts their stickers up, and then you can get up to the paper to put your sticker on. This works a lot slicker because it's all online. You just click, 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 and off you go. So it speeds it up. But do consider a visioning team session if you haven't done that in a while. Select new members carefully. Make sure they're a good fit with your club and that your club meets their expectations. And finally, continue your club's efforts to end polio by donating to End Polio Now and by hosting a World Polio Day event in October. As Holgar said, we must fulfill the promise that we make to the children of the world. Holgar also shared a quote from Paul Harris. He said, If Rotary is to realize its proper destiny, it must be evolutionary at times, revolutionary on occasion. And Hogarth suggested that this is one of those times to be bold and make revolutionary change. Keep in mind, he said this pre-COVID. Now, post-COVID, we're in a time of rapid change. With COVID and all the implications that has on the economy, on how we are able to meet and interact with each other, the killing of George Floyd, and the elevated dialogue on systemic racism, not only in this country, but across the globe, and of course, the contentious election season ahead. Rotary can play a pivotal role in these times by doing what we do best, bringing people together to solve problems which build goodwill and peace. Our membership brings together and values diversity of thought and perspective, which positions us better than others to solve these challenges. As I mentioned in my comments at the installation, what impressed me the most about Rotary is that it goes beyond politics, beyond governments, beyond religions, all of the institutions that have a tendency to divide us, and instead focuses on our common humanity and making a difference in the lives of others. At the installation, I also stated that my number one goal is that Rotary remain relevant. Let's go back to Paul Harris, who said, "It's well that there is nothing in Rotary so sacred that it cannot be set aside in favor of things better. This is an experimental age in a changing world, and of all things which are worthwhile and progressive are the cumulative effects of preceding successes and failures. We need to embrace the changes that are coming if we're to bring in and nurture the next generation of leaders," which brings us to membership. Holgar envisions, as I mentioned, creating new clubs as a path to growth. Our sister district 5950's experience is that their existing clubs brought in a net gain of 5 members last year. During that same time, they created 3 new innovative clubs, which brought in 75 new members, 60 of whom were brand new to Rotary. The presidents that attended NC Pets, such as Barb, had the opportunity to explore the new club models. And our plan was to offer that training at the Conference of Clubs, which was canceled. It really gave Barb and the other presidents that were there an opportunity to play with the models, get familiar with them, see how they could fit in, given a certain situation, group of people wanted to create a Rotary Club, and looking at the different models, find one that would really work for them. Well, we weren't able to offer that training, but the membership team will be inviting your membership chairs to quarterly Zoom roundtables to share ideas, surface concerns and issues that you may be dealing with, and explore the innovative club models. So do take advantage of those meetings. Steve Griffith, the membership team leader, feels, as I do, that the key to membership in and retention in, is service in Rotary. The upcoming generation is more interested in using their time in service and accomplishing goals versus having meals together and listening to speakers. There's a wonderful book I recommend written by John Kaufman entitled Long Walk on a Dry Road. It tells his story of funding an NGO, founding an NGO rather, whose goal was to bring sustainably clean water to communities in other parts of the world. He quickly realized it would take him years to raise enough money to get it off the ground. So he looked around for a solution, and he found a turnkey organization to make his dream come true. He joined Rotary. He was doing something like 6 or 7 installations a year pre-COVID. But when you think about it, he didn't join Rotary. Rotary joined him. I shared this perspective with a couple of potential members to our club before they signed up. I asked them the question, what are you passionate about? What would you like to see changed in the community or in the world? Where do you want to make a difference? Let Rotary join you in that effort. When you have members coming in with a passion for service and a goal in mind, they become the champion for that effort. That's how goals get accomplished. Play to people's strengths. Give them the opportunity to lead, and there's the key to retention. The foundation, first, congratulations and thank you for your support of the Push 400K campaign last June. We ended up with $445,000 towards the annual fund. Every club in the district participated, and we all made a big difference. We surpassed our best year ever in 2017-18 of $415,000. And we also made our goal of Polio Plus with over $150,000, thanks in part to Joe and Paul for jumping in the river. The foundation team will be introducing fun ways to make giving more compelling this coming year, leading people to hopefully making larger commitments. Why is this important? not for the sake of the money and hitting goals and looking good. It's for the good we do. Realize that gifts to the foundation translate into projects that support the now 7 focus areas that Rotary has established. Disease prevention and treatment, which is why I harp on COVID, water sanitation and hygiene, maternal and child health, basic education and literacy, community and economic development, and brand new, starting next year, will be the environment, near and dear to my heart, as Bev mentioned. And all of these 6 flow into the remaining one, which is peace and conflict prevention resolution. And now all 7 of our Rotary focus areas underpin the concept of positive peace, which I'll talk about a little bit later. Why is there such a focus on supporting the foundation? Our clubs are proposing more projects, and that has been outstripping the funds that we have available for matches. So we end up matching 78 cents to the dollar that your club contributes. We want to be able to match dollar for dollar. So there's 3 ways you and your club can help. First, E-Rate, every Rotarian every year. We ask that the Rotary Foundation becomes one of your charities of choice. The foundation has an outstanding record of stewardship and accountability, 12 consecutive years of a 4-star rating, the highest rating. There's only 1% of charities that Charity Navigator evaluates that has received 12 consecutive 4-star ratings. It's a big deal. Having worked in the nonprofit arena for most of my career, no questions asked, this is a tremendous accomplishment. Plus, you can direct how the money is spent into one of the 7 focus areas, to Polio Plus, or into the annual fund, which will come back to the district and your club to support your own project idea. When everyone makes a contribution that works for them, it makes the foundation that much stronger, and we accomplish that much more in the world. There's an old Russian proverb that says, if everyone gives up a thread, the poor man will have a shirt. So please, consider being part of an E-Ray club. We have a new category of giving. Rather than $100 a year, $365, $1 a day. Giving $1 a day to the Rotary Foundation would go a long way to covering the gap in the grants match. Or if you prefer, consider becoming a member of the Paul Harris Society. That's $20 a week. This leads to an annual contribution of $1,000 to the foundation and a Paul Harris Fellow or a Fellow Plus recognition and our gratitude. We currently have 170 members in the district that are Paul Harris Society members. When I read the Rotarian each month and see what other clubs are doing, I used to think, how cool, our club should be doing that. But being in a small club, there's only so much we can do. Then I realized, wait a minute, we are doing that project because we support the Rotary Foundation. We're standing right there alongside that Rotary Club in Colorado or India or the Philippines or wherever Rotarians are doing good. We are one Rotary. Public image, telling our stories, letting the community know what we're accomplishing. It used to be somewhat easier when newspapers were thriving, but today we need to look towards social media as a way to get the word out. And of course you have Sean on board who knows all about this stuff, leading the charge for the district. But an example is I received an email from a woman I know who attended the virtual installation, which because of COVID, we put online, we put on Facebook, and she isn't part of Rotary. And she wrote, it was interesting to find out all the important work that Rotary does and that women can be in the club too. You're surrounded by good, caring people putting good energy into this world. That's the place to be. After watching so much news lately, it felt grounding and confirming to listen to all the positive vibes being shared by your group. She went on, unfortunately, my health prevents me from volunteering. Now that I'm aware of what Rotary is doing and know politics or religion, I would be honored to make a donation. And she did. One newer area that I would encourage clubs to explore is the concept of positive peace. Negative peace is simply the absence of war. Positive peace goes a little bit deeper. And it comes out of our partnership with the Institute of Economics and Peace. You can find out more about it on Rotary.org. And I'll be sharing a list of different contacts for your president to share with you all later on to find out more about these things. The Institute for Economics and Peace was formed in 2007. They did a lot of research. They formulated 23 indicators that determine how peaceful a country is. Those 23 indicators were distilled into 8 elements of peace, which illustrate how much positive peace a country is experiencing. Basically, the better the score, the more peaceful the country. When citizens are supported and needs are being met, we eliminate the need for conflict. Rotary's Foundation's 7 focus areas will feed into those 8 elements, so it was natural for the two organizations to pair up for their common goal of world peace. Rotary has created a PowerPoint presentation complete with a script for clubs to use for a program. Please consider it for one of your meetings. Mentoring is another great way clubs can get involved during this time of COVID. Sean Berry created a mentor-mentee sign-up page on the web. Last November, we held a mentoring meetup in St. Paul at Summit Brewery. Rotaractors, Rotecs, and Rotarians were invited to sign up and indicate what field they had an interest or what field they had knowledge of or were interested in learning more about. There were some great conversations and connections made. We had planned to do another round this spring, but the quarantine intervened. So we're developing a system where Rotecs, Rotaractors, and younger Rotarians will be paired with Rotarians to connect on their own. If you haven't signed up yet, please consider doing it. It's a great way to give vocational service. You can find the link on the website. Rotary's action steps to the strategic plan that I mentioned earlier include expanding our reach and enhancing participant engagement, and keeping in mind that we want to remain relevant. Here are 2 things they are doing to accomplish this. Last fall, Rotary's Board of Directors adopted a statement on diversity, equity, and inclusion. It reads, "As a global network that strives to build a world where people unite and take action to create lasting change, Rotary values diversity and celebrates the contributions of people of all backgrounds, regardless of their age, ethnicity, race, color, abilities, religion, socioeconomic status, culture, sex, sexual orientation, and gender identity. Rotary will cultivate a diverse, equitable, and inclusive culture in which people from underrepresented groups have greater opportunities to participate as members and leaders." And then on June 1st, Rotary International released this following statement on racism. "At Rotary, we have no tolerance for racism. Promoting respect, celebrating diversity, demanding ethical leadership, and working tirelessly to advance peace are central tenets of our work. We have more work to do to create more just, open, and welcoming communities for all people. We know there are no easy fixes and that challenging conversations and work lie before all of us. Rotary's strength has long been our ability and commitment to bringing people together. We will tap into that strength now as we stand with those who are working for peace and justice. Rotary will do our part to listen, learn, and take action to ensure that we continue to contribute to making positive change. The Rotary International Board of Directors is meeting this month here in July to discuss and recommend action steps to be taken on the issue of equity, diversity, and inclusion." Our district has a team exploring these same issues. They've begun weekly meetings to gain a common understanding of the impact systemic racism has on all of us. Part of that is to understand the terminology in the literature. You know, as part of Pass for Hope, as Bev pointed out, she and I both went to Nicaragua early to help develop the vision for the initiative with the Rotary Club of Messiah and the NGO Kairos. I was astounded by the complexity of reaching an agreement and a vision statement while working with 2 different languages and cultures. We all wanted the same thing, but the words and their nuances, once translated, got in the way. In the same vein, we all have different life experiences and understandings, and it takes a genuine, honest openness to bridge the divides. The South Metro Networking Rotaractors have launched a book club around the issue. I encourage clubs to consider doing the same thing. We can recommend titles that can begin the exploration. You can read the book and then schedule a meeting or two to discuss it and come up with ideas. That team at the district level that I mentioned is also going to be coming up with ideas that they can share with clubs throughout the district. As I indicated in my comments at the installation, this isn't going to be comfortable, but it's necessary, and we each have to do our part. The ethics team has been offering a presentation explaining the Braver Angels organization. They used to be known as the Better Angels, and they had to change their name because there was another nonprofit out there by the name of Better Angels who was taking a little bit of issue with the fact that Braver Angels was calling themselves Better Angels. It began as a grassroots organization after the 2016 election, where they got together to see if Hillary supporters and Trump supporters could get together and have a civil conversation. Well, the good news is that it turns out with a little help, they could. So consider having the ethics team give the presentation. It will tell you about the program and that its goal is to reach across the political divide to depolarize the country. If you take the skills workshop, it will actually help you in having those difficult, uncomfortable conversations around racism and equity. And the skill workshops are now being offered online, so it's an easy thing to get into. They're also launching a new program titled With Malice Towards None to help the country come to terms and move forward together after this year's election. Another area that creates peace and understanding is youth exchange, and I know you've been involved with that. Although we won't be having an exchange this year, we can continue to lay the foundation for success in the future by promoting the program to students, potential host families, and schools. This year, North Star Youth Exchange will be focusing on refining and improving their systems, as well as developing marketing materials using social media to reach out to students. It appears that many students have fled Facebook now, the younger generation, since the boomers have taken it over. And there are another platform, so that's what we're going to be reaching out to. Human trafficking is another important issue we're working on together with the other two districts in the state. Many of our clubs have initiated projects, and there's still more work there to be done as well. Polio, finally, I think Holger summed it up beautifully. We must keep our promise to the children of the world. Well, enough of me. Thanks for taking the time today, and we'll throw it open to questions at this point.
Thank you so much. That was fantastic. I have a question, Ed. You were talking about that depolarizing like session. They teach you how to have amicable conversations. Is it possible that we can get a link for that?
Yeah, I've got a sheet. As you go to these district visits, district governor visits, you realize I'm not quite prepared. I should have had this. I have this now, so I will share it with Barb later. I was going to throw it in the chat room, but apparently I can't drop it in there as a file. But I'll get it to Barb, and she'll get it out to everybody. And there's a link there for Braver Angels, and they're offering the courses online. Back in 2018, we offered the training, the district did, and we did we did sessions in three different places that evening. It was October 18th, right before the election. We did it up in New Richmond, Wisconsin, and Roseville, and down in Northfield. We had 100 Rotarians involved with it. And basically how this got started is Bill Doherty, who's a professor at the University of Minnesota in family counseling, took the family counseling skills he teaches as a professor and put it into politics. So they brought 10 Hillary supporters along with 10 Trump supporters into a room, and he kind of guided the conversations and brought these people together. It was amazing. There was a Muslim gentleman who was linked up with an evangelical Christian man, you know, Trump supporter and a Hillary supporter, brought the two of them together. They had conversations. They became the best of pals. They go to mosque together, they go to church together, and, you know, share meals and have a friendship growing. And it's all about understanding the other's perspective. It goes back to a time when in politics we used to have this quaint phrase called compromise. You give a little bit, I give a little bit, and we can work together towards a common good, which is really what Rotary is all about. We've got people from across the political divide as Rotarians that can set that aside to focus in on that humanity I talked about earlier. I mean, this is really kind of another arrow in our quiver. And that malice towards none, I'm going to be taking that to the ethics team to talk about. And I think it's something we're going to promote and roll out to clubs. When I was first reading about it, they took you to a page where there were some testimonials, people writing about it. And there was one gentleman there writing about it saying, this is something that civic organizations should take on and you know, should get involved with. This is going to be good for the country. It's going to be a contentious time. And that was signed by John Huco, CEO of Rotary International and Braver Angels member, you know, which shows you where Rotary is heading. And that statement that they came out with last fall just blew me away on diversity, equity, and inclusion. They're really committed with this new vision and really moving this organization forward to support everybody. It's exciting stuff. But we'll get that link to you. Thank you, Myra.
Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Ed, I would second that. I work in a school that has a number of different student clubs that have been meeting all summer around everything from racial justice and equity to social consciousness, to the political kind of election committee. So that material as far as guiding civic conversations is always something I'm looking for. There's never a bad time to have courageous conversations for sure, but the Rotary guidance on that would be welcome. So thanks for sharing that.
Yeah, and there's a link then too to the equity statements that
right.
Rotary did in the material I'll share with Barb. So we'll get that to you.
That's great. Thank you.
Yep. We're really at an inflection time in history, I think. This is finally, we're at the point where I think we're going to be able to move through. When you consider that New Zealand had a march with 1,000 people marching to the U.S. Embassy in support of what happened, you know, in protest for what happened to George Floyd. You know, last year, I think Rotary did a good job connecting the world. Go Paul, right? Because it's really showing how we are connected. And I think a lot of it has to do with social media and the internet, and it's really bringing people together. Any other questions I'm going on? Jump in.
Ed, how's your daughter doing?
Oh, thank you for asking. For those of you who may not know, she is dealing with cancer. It came on last year. Last year was spent with chemo, and then there was surgery in the fall, and then radiation, and then there was a growth starting. It was breast cancer. So now we're dealing with stage 4 metastatic breast cancer. It's kind of spread everywhere. And Sue is going to be with us today because she knows Carolyn and wanted to say hello and wanted to join me on these visits. But Mandy is in this morning to get another transfusion. So it's kind of a battle, and we're changing up the therapy right now. And so any thoughts, prayers, most welcome, would appreciate it. And if anyone is out there as a blood donor, thank you from the bottom of my heart. I've been a donor for a number of years myself and do the platelets, and that really helps people in Mandy's situation when they're really, really up against the wall there. It really gives them a, you know, you're walking with them. It's really the accompaniment. It really is.
Yeah. Well, you've got a lot on your plate, and you're doing a great job so far. So you got our thoughts and prayers for sure.
Thank you.
And good to get that plug in for blood.
Yep. Any other questions? Otherwise, you could give me an answer and we could play Jeopardy. No? Okay.
Most fun club.
It is.
That's the answer. What's the question?
Oh. Well, of course, it's the North St. Paul Maplewood Oakdale Club. with Randy and his quizzes. I've enjoyed those when I've come to visit. It's keeps you thinking.
Any more questions for Ed? I
ruined my quiz by getting it on the first clue.
It's because
so everybody knows that Alaska is the most north and the most western state. Does anybody know why it's the most eastern state?
I've been there.
That doesn't make it the most eastern state.
Because the road that is the furthest east that was built.
It's because the
international
islands cross the eastern the most eastern longitudinal line. So it's the most west and the most eastern state.
Well, I was Randy, on that road.
Randy, does that mean it crosses the internet part of the islands? The Aleutians cross the international dateline then?
I believe that would be correct. Yeah, I'm not sure. I just It's the most eastern longitudinal, which you would think would be the international date line, but I'd have to check that. Claudia would know that. Too.
You know, at the virtual installation, we had Merwin Wright, who is my counterpart with the district that the GSE team came from, and then Ainsley joined us, the team lead, who you all know, joined the virtual installation as well. So that was fun to have them. It was 10 o'clock in the morning for them, so it wasn't too hard to join us when we held it in the evening. So,
well, you'd be happy to know last week you got zero, and this week you got 100%, thanks to knowing me. See, I would like to say one other thing about
the international date line.
Say what?
I think we lost her.
I would like to say about the raffle tickets. I'm telling everybody that the drawing's going to be September 11th.
I'm having trouble with my connection.
It's going to be September 11th, so which it would be, was the original date for the drawing. So, and I can't remember if it's printed on the card or not. But
it's assuming printed on the card. It is printed on the card.
Right. So that's your deadline for moving tickets, and then we can have some when we do our Zoom meeting for that morning. Maybe we can have Sean do the drawing or something in his office or something. Have one of his many workers pull it. Say, Sean, that reminds me. I didn't see Kristen on the. So I don't know if she's back in town or not. Maybe I could drop by your place and pick up some more tickets.
She has most of them. I have, I think, maybe 20 here.
I'll send her an email and see when she's going to be back.
She's back on the 20th.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
What's the date today?
Yep. 17th. Well, so she'll be back on Monday.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, that's soon enough. I'd like to thank Assistant District Governor Bev Driscoll and District Governor Ed Merrick for joining us this morning. We appreciate it, and you've been very informative. And I'd like to leave everyone with an inspirational quote. I've come to believe that each of us has a personal calling that's as unique as a fingerprint, and that the best way to succeed is to discover what you love and then find a way to offer to others in the form of service, working hard, and also allowing the energy of the universe to lead you. That's from Oprah Winfrey, Media Mogul. Okay, with that, I'll adjourn the meeting. And like I said, everybody with the board, please stay on.